Today I'm talking about one of my favorite shows, Farscape.
And?
I really, really like talking about Farscape.
Farscape is the project Brian Henson is proudest of. Farscape is what James Gunn considers a major influence on Guardians of the Galaxy. Farscape is a beloved cult sci-fi show that pops up in the most unexpected places. It doesn't take itself too seriously and yet still poses profound questions. It explores some truly dark moments but keeps a grin on its face amid all the horror. It emulates the absurdity and cruelness of life while providing some of the most emotional moments I've seen on TV. As the creators put it, they dial the emotions up to 11. So let's explore where Farscape came from, why it works, and why it matters. Farscape was conceived in the early 1990s by Rockne S. O'Bannon and Brian Henson, who was looking to showcase the full potential of the Creature Shop. Originally titled Space Chase, it was pitched to Fox in 1993 and proceeded to lay in limbo until it was picked up by Sci-Fi for 22 episodes. In what would be a defining moment, the president of Sci-Fi explicitly asked to make it as weird as you can, because I don't want a kid's show.
We started to realize that we were making something different and that we had permission to make something different and edgy.
So the restraints were off, and they set out to make a wilder space opera with a more primal energy. Shooting took place in Australia for financial reasons, but they would soon credit Australia with being a key factor in the success of the show.
But the Australian television market, 18 million people, doesn't support high-budget shows.
O'Bannon and Henson sought writers who could distance themselves from the military structure of Star Trek and fight against following any kind of formula. O'Bannon took a more hands-off approach as the series grew, with David Kemper showrunning and dividing his time between Australia and California. This led to the show taking bolder moves and becoming even wilder in season 2 on. Farscape really benefited from not being a single person's vision. Farscape was run almost democratically. Whether it was Ben Browder or one of the puppeteers, if someone had an episode idea or felt the dialogue needed changing, they were free to speak up.
When we did make suggestions, and the directors would embrace them.
Australian culture kept the cast, crew, and writers feeling equally important, bringing out the most creativity from everyone. And this was how Farscape was run, in a sort of chaos and equality, and it's beautiful. So why does it work? Farscape isn't focused on an outfit or organization. It's not a glimpse into a different galaxy with no anchor to our own. This is one human like any of us that has to survive in a hostile alien land. A fish out of water story akin to shows like Buck Rogers. And John isn't a captain or a fighter. He has none of the skills that the others
have. Look, I'm not entirely useless here, you know.
He's a pilot and knows his physics. That's his backstory. But most of his skills he builds with us over the series. And we discover each new planet and species with John. And when we meet a new alien, we don't get the sci-fi babble explanation. We get Crichtonisms, relatable human reactions, joking like many of us would when confronting such bizarre beings.
All right, Frankenstein, let's get it on.
We journey with John into impossible situations, and choices must be made. Choices that will have consequences. And because John serves as a relatable anchor, it allows the viewer to feel as capable as him in getting out of these situations.
You know, you could probably imagine yourself as John. What do you do if you're stuck at the other end of the universe and you have no clue what's going on?
I still try to problem solve while watching episodes, especially with a returning villain, and I think, okay, what did we do last time? There's no super smart, super strong protagonist to bail us out. And when we lose, the effects are felt. There's no fresh start at the beginning of each episode. Nothing resets. Problems are either solved or suffered. We learn, we grieve, we have hope. And it's a lot to ask of a viewer. If John hadn't been from Earth, I don't believe this show would have worked for me. It'd be more laid back for the viewer, a sort of, this is their world, they know about this stuff, they'll figure something out. There's an intimacy with the audience that's built using the Man from Earth tactic. It makes such a fantastic alien world our world too. The crew of the Enterprise is capable, trained, and doing their job. There's no anchor for the present-day everyman. I'd be completely useless on the crew. But the crew of Moya is loud, chaotic, and a mess, because they're winging it. No one's there on purpose. They're just doing the best they can, as any of us would. If you enjoy staying inside most of your life playing video games like myself, then these characters will feel like an assortment of pre-made roles in an RPG. The warrior, the thief, the priest, the king. And each has their own customs, culture, beliefs, motivations, skills, abilities. Each actor poured their all into performances. Virginia Hay, playing Zan, the 800-year-old plant, put such effort into seeming alien with stillness, avoiding any instinctive fight or flight, as she put it. And the dedication, even after her kidneys started to bleed from wearing blue makeup over the years, Hay still wanted to return for 5-8 episodes a season. Other performances, such as Chiana's, could seem goofy at times. She adopted these distinct, accentuated head movements to seem alien, but that was how she managed the contacts she wore that gave her tunnel vision on an already dark set. The character was supposed to be killed off, but the chemistry was so good she stayed on. Wayne Pygram was absolutely fantastic as Scorpius, such a wonderfully unique villain. It's a treat to listen to any interview of him delving into his character. He has a thought process for everything. How he decided to keep a higher voice, not only because it sounded creepy, but because he reasoned it was Scorpius' way of distancing himself from his scare in half. He also has a much darker view of his character than many of the fans would expect, or like, sinking to no low of manipulation to get what he wanted. For those who have watched the show, Wayne believes Scorpius made up the entire backstory of his tortured upbringing, all to further manipulate John into turning against the Scarrans. The beauty of Scorpius, though, was only enhanced by Harvey, the implanted consciousness of Scorpius into John's mind. This was the writer's answer to allowing a beloved villain to take on a new role, getting to work the chemistry he had with John without diminishing the threat of the flesh and blood villain. Inarguably, John Crichton, out of all the characters, has had the most observable impact on science fiction. Ben Browder actively sought to unkirk himself at every turn. John is unpredictable, confusing, and literally sometimes on the brink of insanity throughout the series.
He's crazy!
Isn't it fun?
A protagonist that is often pushed to the edge, and doesn't mind strapping a nuke to his waist to throw everyone's plans into chaos. Because it's in chaos that John functions, and often thrives.
Our lead characters, our protagonist, should be role models, something that someone can look up to. John Crichton fell off that cart years ago.
It's engaging and exciting, possibly the farthest you can get from Picard. And after so many stiff protagonists in science fiction, it feels like a breath of fresh air. And now, ever since Farscape, it seems there's a little Crichton in all our quote-unquote Kirks. Henson noticed this too. He remarked after seeing the 2009 Star Trek movie that Chris Pine was channeling some of that Crichton. He stated, "Wait a second, he's John Crichton. He's gone to that wilder and unpredictable place. Star Trek never used to go there."
"If I may be honest, John, most of the time I have no idea what you're saying."
"Neither do I."
The unique interpersonal dynamics on Farscape are one of the primary reasons it was such a good show. They created these by doing something really special. They left out a captain. I can't think of any sci-fi crews that don't have a captain, but it left the playing field level for all the characters. The interpersonal dynamics are so gripping because each character had a say. They all fought for a sense of power, superiority, and this allowed for varied approaches to situations, as each had their own unique ways of handling problems. It was so nice to see when Rygel would save the day lying like a politician, or Zahn would work her mysticism. But it was even better when they all mixed together, kinda Ocean's Elevening it. With a captain, you have one voice, and there's often a preferred way to handle most confrontations, and you come to know this very well. With no form of rank, the characters were allowed to really push each other to find each other's limits, developing truly deep relationships. John and Dargo's is my absolute favorite. In fact, my favorite buddy team of all time.
"Dargo, tell him who his daddy is."
"I'm your daddy."
It starts off so volatile, but grows to a deep admiration and respect.
"I love you."
It's built slow, but it needs that time and turmoil to allow for such an immensely satisfying payoff to the viewers. And it only would have worked if the dynamics put them as equals, always fighting for top dog, knowing the superior.
"You're the closest friend I have."
They eventually do choose a captain, Dargo. But that's halfway through the last season, and it's again such a rewarding experience because of the long road it took for him to gain the respect and admiration of his shipmates.
"I'm your daddy."
John and Aaron subverted a number of tropes with their gender norm reversal on the classic love story. Aaron played the silent, strong type, reserved, closed off, and John wore his heart on his sleeve. He liked to talk things out, was well-spoken, and in tune with his emotions. It was Aaron who had to come around to being open to love, as cliche as that sounds. Browder summed this twist in the love story quite nicely with,
"Boy meets girl, girl kicks boy's ass."
In addition to the norm swap, the writers really tried to steer away from a will-they-won't-they trope. Tension is held for a while, but John and Aaron have sex fairly early on in the series. The tension repeats one more time when one of the Johns dies, but then they get married at the end of season 4. The writers had no idea they were going to be canceled. They fully intended for a fifth season, but this goes to show they were smart with how much buildup is entertaining without being an eye roll. Now, this isn't a very novel idea anymore. The decline or rise of a character over a series is common, and a frequently cited reason by fans for liking shows like BoJack or Breaking Bad. But Farscape found that sweet spot between the new adventure every week with the same old crew and each decision matters because it will change your characters forever. If I were to compare the ratio of growth and consistent deliveries to another show, I would choose The Sopranos. Now, most likely this is because I have been watching a lot of Sopranos recently, but there is a perfect ratio of character consistency to serious consequences. Just as The Sopranos have two characters filling a particular role that gives Tony a villain to play off of, Richie and Ralphie, Farscape has Zahn and Arante to guide the emotional or mystical aspects for John. They're different, unique, and once they're gone, they can be lost forever. But there's this role they fill, which gives it the slight reminiscence of a sitcom. A loose comparison, but it works for relating the right level of growth. The vision for Farscape was always chasing that one adjective, weird, and it certainly reached its goal. I love the creativity in every storyline and character. Seeing a 17th century dressed fear vampire one episode, and a lab rat that injects himself with alien DNA the next. But there's a line that can't be crossed. Making things weird for the purpose to shock. And Farscape never crosses this, because it had the necessary framework to add in the odd. The stories, characters, and motivations were solid, then they added in the layer of making it weird. Let's look at a show that skipped this step. Lexx was a show that aired 2 years prior to Farscape, that just so happened to also feature a group of outcasts traveling around on a living ship. But if Star Trek is the sci-fi blueprint, and Farscape is the right mix of weird and sexy, then Lexx goes to the extreme, losing emotion in exchange for shock. I commend Lexx for being so truly bizarre and unique, things I genuinely appreciate. But they didn't build proper character motivations. The primary drive for most of the crew on Lexx is to have sex, and it's very adolescent. This then hurts any weird creativity, because it feels as if everything is being done to gain that controversial tag, and you see this in comedy too. Taboo or shocking material is not inherently entertaining, and it can be very transparent when that is your goal. Farscape does have its adolescent moments. Dargo is actually supposed to be an adolescent, but it put in the work to be able to go there. Take this joke, for example.
The bad news is that you're married, and you must endure as a statue for 80 cycles in a strange world.
What's the good news?
Chiana and I are having fantastic sex.
The joke isn't, I'm having sex. The joke is unexpected levity at an all's lost moment. Because Farscape built a mature framework, they can add in layers, and any weirdness will come off as genuine. It also helps that reactions from the crew, particularly John, express bewilderment at all the odd happenings and bizarre people. This adds realism to the weirdness. Our lies are absurd. Humans can be absolutely mind-boggling in their decisions and motivations. The People's Church, Flat Earthers, 5G Doomsayers, but it's our reality, and if John were to respond nonchalantly to the weird cults and characters he meets, it wouldn't feel real. There's an emulation of real life in the insanity Farscape presents, and it presents it on top of a solid framework that, along with John's incredulousness, makes Farscape's weirdness work.
How stupid is that?
So I've outlined why Farscape works for me. Because of the characters, their dynamics, the right level of growth and weirdness, and because of John's relatableness. But who cares? What does Farscape have to tell us on any meaningful level? How does it impact my life? Well, to illustrate this, I want to examine two stories that I find very special. Season 2, Episode 8 has Zahn, Rygel, and Chiana alone on Litigara, a planet full of corrupt lawyers. In short, Zahn becomes embroiled in a political scandal and accused of a crime for which the punishment is death. She believes her closest allies, John, Dargo, and Aaron, are dead, and she breaks.
I am so deeply alone.
Coming from such a composed character, it is so emotionally gutting to see her beg for her friends.
I need you here to rescue me.
And finally, hopelessly welcome death.
I committed that murder.
It is such a raw and vulnerable moment. and since Farscape has a rule of having consequences, the emotional scars from this ordeal remain in Zan. She exhibits something akin to PTSD from emotional trauma, and it follows her into other episodes.
Dargo can save us. He can! He has to save us!
I have quoted Sebastian Younger in past videos, and I think his words fit here perfectly. First, he states that the type of friendship between deployed platoon mates is incredibly deep, and can only be developed if immersed as they were in an alien landscape, wholly reliant upon each other and under constant threat of mortal danger. This is the exact situation the crew of Moya are in. Beings who would probably never be friends elsewise, banded together as their only hopes of surviving in this harsh alien universe. Younger goes on to state that PTSD develops because the returning soldier is no longer part of a group, bound together by a clear sense of purpose, familiar rituals, and shared experiences.
But you still have nightmares.
Yes. I keep seeing you and Dargo and Eren dying horrible deaths.
This hits me on such an emotional level because Zan's pain is so tangible. I don't know the pain on the level of a soldier ripped from his group, but I relate on a level that I know. I've been alone in new cities. I've been in turmoil without support from those I need. There's a reason people cling to TV shows, especially when they're lonely. They feel like a group to be a part of, a placebo family. And when in those lows, Farscape genuinely comes the closest to making me feel one of the crew. There needs to be the highs and the lows. Things will never get dark enough on a sitcom to make me feel like I've gone through the shit with them. Farscape doesn't shy away from grief, sex, gore, or more taboo topics like rape. The episode Home on the Remains even managed to get an 18 years of age and older certificate in the UK for a scene of a man's skin sloughing off. It's emotions dialed up to 11, and that's why Farscape matters to me, my placebo family. The last story I want to mention is John's arc. John's basic storyline is, people want my wormholes, leave me alone, and it primarily drives the series, specifically the villains. And throughout, John's motivation to find a home never changes. But amidst the conflict in the motivation is John's purpose, and that changes just once. The astronaut lost in space wants so desperately to return to Earth, to be home again. But when he returns, something isn't right. He feels out of place.
And everyone is telling me how different I am. They're right.
And Farscape didn't write in some catastrophe that would cause John to be adrift in space again, continuing once again with his purpose to go to Earth. They examined a character who lost his purpose entirely, who had to come to grips with that and let go of everything he thought he was. His life aboard Moya now felt more like home to him than Earth, and he couldn't go home again.
Well, where do you want to live?
I don't know.
Being able to let go of something you believed was so fundamentally important to you, a life trajectory, is difficult to say the least. And we experience this death of purpose in our own lives too. Perhaps when a career we thought was going to be our passion turns out to be unfulfilling, or when you grow apart from the person you thought you were going to grow old with, becoming a different person than when you first met. It's a painful process, and honestly one I see many people avoid even going through, avoiding any cognitive dissonance and refusing to make the necessary decisions, because moving on is hard. Feeling adrift without purpose and knowing who you are is tough. But it was nice to see that portrayed on TV, and done so earnestly. Farscape had a contract with Sci-Fi for season 5 and 6, but ratings were dropping, and with another regime change and a new direction for the channel, it was canceled after negotiations backfired. David Kemper remarked on a Sci-Fi chat board, "Sci-Fi is not going to exercise its option to pick up the fifth year. Yesterday, we all cried on set. Frel." Room was made for reality programming, and Farscape was left on a cliffhanger. Thankfully, outraged fans made enough noise to catch the attention of some European investors, and independently raised $20 million for the Peacekeeper Wars miniseries. The miniseries is obviously crammed in a slim version of what was intended for a final season. Entire plot lines had to be removed, and character deaths, namely Jules, felt hollow. However, it was a much-needed conclusion to a show that captivated so many. Webisodes have been talked about since 2007, along with a possible big-screen movie, but I would not expect either. Farscape has lived on in comics that are considered canon, but I'm not sure I need any more Farscape. Farscape was a right place, right time, right people gift, and it's some good dren.